Welcome to another edition of the Purple Book. My name is Pastor Steve McKinney, and we are going through this as a church, but we're making this available to the whole world, anybody that wants to join us. And we are currently in chapter one, which is entitled Sin and Salvation, and we're going into lesson number four. And lesson number four, it's about receiving God's gift, a new heart. As a result of receiving God's sacrifice, Jesus Christ, as the payment for our sins, we not only experience forgiveness from the past, but we are given a new heart and a new life as God's children. That's a really, really key statement, guys. Jesus is actually our payment. All right. That's one of the things that Jesus is. He was the payment. He is the payment for our sins. He's the one that pays the ransom, and the ransom is He Himself. He dies on the cross in our place. What an awesome, awesome thing. And I love this. Not only do we receive forgiveness from our sins, but we are given literally a new heart, and we are given a new life as God's children. We are no longer children of the world or children of the devil, as the Bible says in another place, but we are now children of God. All right, let's go into number one. What did God promise He would give His people? And Ezekiel chapter 36, verse 26 says, "A new heart and a new spirit," okay? Now, there is the Holy Spirit, but there is also the human spirit, okay? We are spiritual beings. When we die, we leave this body, and it is our spirit that goes on forever, okay? But we receive a new spirit. We receive a spirit that will forever be a child of God. God is spirit, so we worship Him in spirit and in truth, and we receive that spirit that worships Him in spirit and in truth. And we no longer have hearts of stone. Now, you know, to think about a heart of stone, it's pretty obvious that you would not want a stone in your physical heart. Because if you had a stone in your physical heart, it would be very hard. It would not be pliable. We don't want to be hard-hearted. We want to be soft-hearted. We want to be tender-hearted. We want to be merciful. We want to be loving. We want to be kind. We want to love God, and we want to love other people. And He changes our hearts, and He gives us soft hearts, and He takes away our hearts of stone, and instead He gives us hearts of flesh. And by the way, the Bible talks about that in more than just one place. All right, guys, number two, what does God do when He rescues us from our state of spiritual death? I love this question. Ephesians 2 verses 4 to 6 let us know that He makes us alive with Him, not only with Him, but also in Him. And He raises us up to be seated with Him in heavenly places. Guys, our future is awesome, okay? And He makes us alive, alive forever, alive for all eternity. And He seats us with Him to be co-heirs with the Lord Jesus Christ. Number three, what happens when we receive Jesus as Lord and Savior? And John chapter 1, verses 12 and 13 lets us know that we are given the right, given the authority to become children of God. Now, I am a child of Everett and Evelyn McKinney, but because I'm born again, I am a child of the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. I'm a child of God, and I am a brother with Jesus Christ. Isn't that an amazing thing? He's my God, but He's also my brother. And it's so wonderful to be a part of the family of God. Now, it says here that we are not born of flesh, all right, but we are born of God. We are born of God. Now, was I born from flesh? Yes, I came out from my mother's flesh. My father had something to do with it, okay? I was born of flesh, but now that I've been born again, I'm not born of flesh. That's no longer my identity. I am born of God. I'm in the family of God, and I will rule and I will reign with Him forever. We have been given an incredible heritage, and we've been given an incredible future in the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, number four asks this. What did Jesus say must happen before we can enter the kingdom of God? And John chapter 3, verses 3 to 7 just gives us a synopsis, and it is this. We become born again. Okay, we become born again. In other words, the being born again is being born into the family that gives us life forevermore. Okay, you cannot enter the kingdom of heaven unless you are born again. That's the only way that anybody enters the kingdom of heaven. Now, the author, John, goes on and he says, you're born of water and spirit. Okay, those who are born again are born of water and spirit. Well, what does it mean to be born of water? Well, how are we born of water? We're baptized in water. What ends up happening is we go down into the water and it's a watery grave. We die to our old nature. We die to our old self and we come up in resurrection power and we are born again. Baptism is actually a death and it is actually a birth. It is a wonderful, wonderful thing. And guys, we get baptized to symbolize what happens to us when we accept Jesus into our lives. He pays the ransom, or he already paid the ransom more than 2,000 years, but we receive the payment, the ransom. We enter the kingdom of God. We enter the family of God. We die to our old self, and we are now resurrected in the Lord Jesus Christ. But it's not just the water. It's also the Holy Spirit. We are born of the Spirit. It's with a capital S is what it says. In John chapter 3, verses 3 to 7. We are born of the Spirit. I want you guys to know, you need the Holy Spirit. I need the Holy Spirit. It is the Holy Spirit that makes us alive in Christ and seals us unto salvation. It is the Holy Spirit that causes us to be born again. You can't even get born again if the Holy Spirit is not drawing you, okay? But it's also the Holy Spirit that seals us and causes us to be led, to causes us to be guided, causes us to adhere to the Word of God and to remain in the family of God. The Holy Spirit is so important. So we're born again of water and of the Spirit of God. Number five, what do the following passages tell you about being born again or born of God? Both of those things work together and they're both really important. And John chapter 1 verses 12 and 13, the synopsis is this. It starts by receiving him. You must receive Jesus. Where? Into your life. You must accept him as your Lord and Savior. You must accept him as your King of Kings and Lord of Lords. You receive him. You give him control. You give him authority and you believe in his name. What does that mean? You believe that he's the way, he's the truth, he's the life, and no one comes to the Father except through him. All right. Number five, but the second verse is this, 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 23. It says here that we come from the imperishable seed of God's word. Guys, Jesus is the word. And nobody gets born again without accepting the true word of God, the Bible, the living, breathing word of God. Guys, the word of God becomes very, very important to us because it is a seed that will never perish. It will remain forever. Okay. And so when we get saved, we become hungry for the word. We become reliant on the word. We become focused on the word of God and we love the word of God and we read and we study the word of God and the word of God comforts us and the word of God directs us and the word of God encourages us and the word of God sustains us. And because the word of God takes a central place in our lives, we are now born of imperishable, it will never perish, imperishable seed from God's word. God's word has a big role to play in us being born again and being born of the water and of the Spirit. 1 John chapter 3, verse 9 says this, God's seed in us. What is that? God's word. And we're being led by the Holy Spirit. God's seed in us prevents us from practicing sin. That word practicing is really, really important. Now, do I sin occasionally? Absolutely, I do. But I have to cut it off and I say, I'm not going to practice that. I'm not going to continue in that. I'm going to ask the Lord to forgive me. I'm going to ask God's power to help me. I'm going to ask the Holy Spirit to help me. So I'm not going to make a practice out of this mistake that I did, out of this sin that I did. I am no longer going to practice sin. Why? Because God's seed is inside of me. God's word is inside of me. The psalmist said, your word I have hidden in my heart so that I might not sin against you. Amen. God's word helps us to prevent from practicing sin. 1 John chapter 4, verse 7 says this, we are born of God, and because we're born of God, we love others. All right. It's only when you are truly born of God that you can truly love others. And not only do we love others, but we also know God. How can you know God if you're not born of God? Okay. So when you're born of God, you know God and you love others. It's a beautiful, beautiful thing. Let's move on to number 6. What does Paul say about those who are in Christ? 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17 says this, we are a new creation. Being a new creation means that the old is gone and the new has come. That new nature has already come on you and you're putting it into practice. You're renewing your mind. You are becoming one with Jesus. You're becoming one with your new nature. The old has gone. The old has died. It's buried in that watery grave. And now the new has come. You are a new creation. You're not a new creation if you haven't rejected the old and embraced the new. Can I get a good amen on that? Hello, is anybody home? Okay. All right. You're a new creation when you reject the old and when you receive the new. But the old is actually the old Steve, the old man, the old you. The new is who I am in Christ. Okay. So I become a new creation, a new creature. Number 7, what is the destiny of those who are born of God? Guys, destiny is a really, really important thing to figure out, okay? You want to have an awesome destiny. And the destiny of those who are born of God is quite different from everybody else. And 1 John chapter 5, verse 4 says this, our destiny is this, we overcome the world. We overcome the world. Those who are born of God overcome the world. Those who are in Christ overcome the world. The world is trying to overcome you, but you need to be an overcomer. You need to overcome the world. You believe that Jesus is the Son of God. Those who believe that Jesus is the Son of God, they overcome the world. Why? Because believing that Jesus is the Son of God, that is the only thing that is going to cause you to overcome the world and to be that new creation, to be a brother of Jesus, to be a child of God. Okay? That is how we overcome the world. All right, let's move into application and reflection. What would you do if someone could offer you a brand new start in life? I like this one, okay? And guys, we know that Jesus gives us a new start, okay? Jesus gives us a new start. But what I would do differently, if I could go back in time, is I would have taken it more seriously earlier. All right. I would have taken this new start that Jesus offers. I would have taken it much more seriously, much earlier in my life. And I would have saved myself a lot of pain and a lot of regret. All right. But Jesus transforms all of that. And I am a new creation and I've been given a new start in him. And it is an awesome thing. The next part of the application reflection is this. Have you received God's gift of new life? You need God's gift of new life. And all that you have to do is receive it. He's already paid the price. He loves you. He's reaching for you. He's calling for you. He died for you. It's not about what you've done. It's about what he's done to erase those things that you have done in your past. So my answer is yes. but I need to do more with the free gift that Jesus has given me. Because you know what, guys? Salvation to me is not just fire insurance. Salvation to me is not just a ticket to heaven. Salvation to me is an opportunity to work with Christ to save others. I want to bring as many people to heaven with me as possible, and I pray that that is your desire as well. Father, I thank you for this lesson. I thank you for this word. I thank you for this time that we've spent together. And Father, I pray over everyone within the sound of my voice right now, Lord, that they would respond to your word, that they would take more time and restudy this, Lord, so that they would understand the opportunity that we have in you to be affected, Lord, by your power, by your love, by your spirit, by your imperishable seed, the word of God. And Father, I pray that every person would know you, every person would surrender to you. And I pray, Father, that every person would be a light, an ambassador for you, all for your glory. I pray this in Jesus' mighty name. Guys, I love you. Thank you for joining me today. Go ahead and rewind this. Play this again. And, you know, really understand this word before you move on to the next lesson. Until the next lesson, God bless you. And may the Lord place a hedge of protection around you, lead you and guide you. And may his countenance shine upon you in Jesus' name. Amen.